joy and delight in the children tonight. God, I ask that your Holy Spirit be upon Pastor Ryan tonight.
Yes.
Your word will not go out void. I pray that we are changed, that we are humbled by you again and again and again by what you do for us. We give you the glory and the praise. In Jesus' name.
That's the only way I can bring an effective word is through the Holy Spirit. So that's the same I got. Look at all them smiling faces out there. Well, you know what, Allison? I know that just because someone's smiling doesn't mean there's not pain on the inside. So here's what I'm thinking. Here's my prayer. Lord, we know it's rough out there, Lord. And we know we might be smiling on the outside but hurting on the inside. But Lord, I pray that we just know we are warriors for your kingdom, Lord, and we're wielding this sword of the Spirit, Lord, your word. And I pray that everyone in here knows that they are a spiritual lion roaring on the inside. And I pray for those who are hurting, Lord, that they can draw closer to you and cling tighter to you in these times that may be dark or these times where they may need to feel you extra, Lord. We pray that you touch them each in the way that they are needed. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to talk about Elijah tonight. Technology. It's okay. So, where was I? So, talking about Elijah, I want to tell a little joke here. Why did the cow, what's this little dog's called? This little weird dog. Okay. Why did the cowboy buy the dachshund? Because he was told to get a long little doggy. Okay? Now, when you go out and tell your faith, because he was told to get a long little doggy. They're little, long little doggies. So, as you go out in the world and talk about your faith, some... Oh, brother, thanks.
Gotta get a good foundation first.
What's that?
Gotta get a good foundation first.
That's right. That's what we talked about at Alive. We might be told to get along, little doggy, when we go out and minister to people. And there'll be people who don't care, don't want to hear it, think you got an agenda. I mean, we do have an agenda. The agenda is to bring more light into this dark world. The agenda is for them to have the same transformation that we had through God in the encounter with Jesus Christ. That's the agenda. We're here to do. It's like a kid who doesn't want to get the medicine on the cut because it's going to hurt. And my grandma would get, like, that iodine stuff. And then if I had poison ivy, she would find like a wash rag that was all gnarled up and don't get the bleach and like scrub my legs with it. We'd be screaming for her. But it would like turn this weird purple color and eventually die. And I don't know if that's a common practice these days or if you'll get a visit from child services. But nonetheless, we didn't want that, but it actually turned out to be good. And some people don't know that when we come and they tell us to get along, little doggy, we say, no, 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 no. I'm coming in as a roaring lion, a lion in spirit. I'm not a little doggy. I might have a temperament or a physical appearance of not intimidating or of less than, but in my spirit, I am a roaring lion. That's how I need to maintain that. So I'm going to be talking about Elijah. So Elijah, there's many. He's awesome, and there's a bunch of stories. Talks about Elijah in 1 Kings. Now, if you guys know about Elijah, he was bad to the bone. He was a prophet of God who went and stood up against evil. He had his times where he faltered, but for the most part, he was just about it. He was getting after God, God's agenda. So, he is such a great prophet. The Jews, I mean, they before Christ came, they heralded him as just this awesome prophet of God. And there's a lot of stuff they wrote about Elijah, a lot of things that they praise Elijah for. And Elijah is still considered like one of the greatest Old Testament prophets. It says John the Baptist came in the spirit of Elijah, and he was there with that repentant sermon of turn away you wicked generation back to God. And that's what Elijah was doing. He was confronting the wicked institution in Israel that had gone so far away from God into idolatry. So here is some things I want you to know about Elijah. He was a man who stood up for God. He was a man of prayer. And he was a man who demonstrates the goodness of God and his holy wrath. He let people know God is not just here to bless you, but he also has another side that's going to hold you accountable.
Amen.
So you've got to be walking in righteousness and holiness. And when you mess up, own it. And Jesus is going to say, look, just try harder. I'm going to help you do this. That's what he says to Christians nowadays. Now you messed up, now you've done it, now you're out. Enjoy hell. He doesn't say that. He says, come on, let's get up. We're going to get after it. And we're going to try harder. And I'm going to be with you. And I'm going to be coaching you on. And I'm going to be your hype. I'm going to be your corner guy, hyping you up. You got this. I'm with you. That's what Jesus does. He's like our hype guy. So, if I was going to pick a team, say this was a confronting evil nation team. This is the game we're playing. We're going to go confront evil nations. My first pick would be Elijah. If Jesus isn't an option, I'd say, I got Elijah. That'd be my first pick. He's a prophet. He's about God's business. I'm not going to read everything that it talks about in Elijah or in 1 Kings. We're going to hit on the main themes. But here's something we need to take from Elijah's life. We need to be men and women of prayer. We need to stand up for the goodness of God. We need to stand up against evil and demonstrate God's love and God's wrath. So, right before Elijah comes into the scene, it's talking about the curse of Joshua. At the end of Joshua, when the walls of Jericho came down, Joshua pronounced this curse. This is Joshua 6, starting in verse 26. Joshua laid an oath on them at the time, saying, cursed before the Lord be the man who rises up and rebuilds the city of Jericho. So they marched around. They put Jericho down by the power of God. You guys know the songs, the walls of Jericho came tumbling down. So Joshua's placing a curse on it. He says, curses anyone who tries to rebuild this city. Cursed before the Lord be the man who rises up and rebuilds the city of Jericho. Here's the curse. At the cost of his firstborn shall he lay its foundation, and at the cost of his youngest son shall he set up its gates. So Joshua is letting know what's going to happen to anybody who tries to raise that city back. And I lost my page. So that's how Elijah comes on the scene. So it says in chapter 17, now Elijah the Tishbite of Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, now Ahab is this wicked king of Israel, and he marries an even more wicked woman named Jezebel. Now, just like you don't see anybody named Adolf anymore, you don't see people named Jezebel anymore. She has so tarnished that name with her wickedness and her Satanism. She was a Satanist who practiced and worshipped demons and brought all of Israel, was trying to bring all of Israel into that demon worship. And that's the scene that Elijah is coming into, this pagan nation, which was actually Israel, the godly nation that was supposed to show the goodness of God and the holiness of God and the awesomeness of God and how the Messiah was going to come through this nation. They were supposed to be the demonstration of God's goodness. And here they are turning to paganism. So this is where Elijah shows up. And God sent prophet after prophet after prophet to the northern kingdom of Israel. And they were killed. And Jezebel was killing them and killing these prophets. And there was a school for prophets in northern Israel that Jezebel was going after the school and killing all the prophets who were learning and studying and doing godly things, that they had to go and hide in caves to flee Jezebel. So it kind of reminds you of present day. They're getting rid of all the godly, they're getting rid of anything godly, and they're putting in its place these idols, these pagan idols of worship that is anti-God and anti the godly agenda. And they're getting rid of anything that showed God. Look at your school systems. Look at your government institutions. Look what they're doing. Baal worship is alive and well today. Jezebel, the spirit of Jezebel and Ahab are running full force through this nation. And you see it happen in other nations across the sea. And how they're just skeletons of what they used to be. And you look around in America and you see they're tearing down the crosses. They're tearing down the Ten Commandments. They're tearing down the Bible out of the schools. And they're slaying the word of God, just like they were slaying the prophets of God back then. So this is the atmosphere that Elijah walks into. And Hebron, his firstborn, and set up its gates at the cost of his youngest son, Segub, according to the word of the Lord, which he spoke by Joshua. So, the Israelites, the Jews, knew that this was prophecy fulfilled from Joshua. So this guy, actually, this came to pass. What God said to Joshua, Elijah shows up on the scene and says, Ahab, look at Hiel. He lost his firstborn. He lost his next kid. Because he's doing it, and Ahab's saying, no, you don't believe that hocus pocus, do you? So here's what Elijah said. He says, I'm going to say there's going to be a drought. My word's going to bring a drought upon this nation. It's not going to rain anymore for 3 years until I say it's going to rain again. So Elijah had to have a connection with God that was cemented, that was so interlocked that he was confident that God would grant him the petitions of his heart. Now, at the same time, God is behind this and orchestrating this. So Elijah says there's a drought coming on the land. He says, it won't rain, it's going to stop raining because I said so, and it's not going to rain until I say so again. Then Elijah goes about his way. God says to Elijah, depart from here and turn eastward and hide yourself by the brook Cherith, which is east of Jordan. You shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. He went and lived by the brook Cherith, that is east of Jordan, and the ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening. He drank from the brook. And after a while, the brook dried up because there was no rain in the land. So, have you ever gotten to a point where I'm serving you, Lord, and I don't see no breakthroughs? I don't see no light at the end of this tunnel. I see it's getting darker, Lord. The pantry is getting bare. The money is running out. Have you ever been there? Where you're trying to make your loose ends meet? Trying to make loose ends meet, you guys ever heard that? You know what I used to think that meant when I was little? I used to think that meant, like, the ends of meat. Like the end parts. And I was trying to figure that out. I was like, Jesus, this is your most complicated parable. What does this mean? But then I realized, okay, trying to make the loose ends meet. And sometimes, you know, our loose ends meet in collections, right? And you think, oh man, they're meeting, but it's getting harder for them to meet. And then the bill collectors come in, and they're like, man, they're meeting, but you've got to remember what God said. He said in Matthew 6:33, he says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added on you. So I look at the formula there, okay? That's A plus B equals C. Seek first the kingdom of God and God's righteousness. That means you're going to be about his business. That means you're going to be about his agenda. That means you're going to be upholding his righteousness. It says that we came and were put here with a purpose and a plan to glorify God. That's the first part. We are made in the image of God. We are supposed to be reflectors of God's image. We are called Christians to be like Christ. So we got to be about God's agenda, and we got to be looking like Jesus as we do it. But it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. So he's talking about what to wear, what to eat, where to live. So we don't have to worry about those physical things. He says, I got your back spiritually, and that's the most important thing. But I got your back in the physical, because I know you got to operate in the physical. So Elijah did that. He was depending on God. Could you imagine if you were hungry and a bird flew up to you with two Big Macs and he said it was a BOGO deal? I brought two. Can you imagine that? That'd be awesome. You'd be like flabbergasted. But they came, the ravens fed Elijah. And he was protected. He was not in danger. And then it goes on, and God sends him to this widow. She's already lost her husband, and he goes there, and the widow of Zarephath. And he comes up and he says, ma'am, I've been on a journey here, will you make me a bread cake, and give me something to drink? And she says, all we got is enough flour and oil for one more cake, and me and my son are going to eat it, and then we're going to die. Okay? So there's people in the world who have that outlook on life. There's people that operate in that, I call it like here's what I think. To use a Disney reference. This world needs more spiritual Tiggers, right? This world has enough spiritual Eeyores in it. We need more tears in the world, less Eeyores. But there's a lot of Eeyores out there who say, it's just this life stinks and there's nothing for me out there. But if they were to look back in the rearview mirror and say, okay, write down all the times that God was blessing you. And if you actually look back in the rearview mirror, you go, man, God, you brought me through that. You brought me through that. You gave me that. You did this. And that's just the things I can bring to remembrance. And that's the things that I don't think are insignificant. But God's working in the seemingly insignificant things. He's working in the big things. He's working in all things. And we can never have that attitude of, what have you done for me lately, God? Because he'll show you, hey, look, before you were conceived, I was doing stuff for you. Before you were conceived, I was ordaining good works for you to walk in. Before you were conceived, I mapped out a plan and a purpose. What are you talking about? What have I done for you lately? I've been doing and I'm going to keep doing. So we need to have that positive attitude. We need to remember that if we stay connected to God, we're not going to know what's going on all the time. We got to step out in faith. Amen. We got to operate, okay, I can't see what's happening. Like I said, I gave the analogy the other day that King David had that severed head of Goliath in his hand, held up in victory before he ever threw that first stone. That was his eyes of faith. He went in. I don't care what the size, stature, I don't care any of that stuff. I come in the name of God, that's being connected. I come in the name of God, I'm tethered to him. I'm coming in his power. I'm coming by his greatness behind me. And that's all that matters. So he knew he was going to be having that head up there. That severed head is graphic, but he took that giant sword and cut that giant head, and he got that giant victory through the faith in God. Amen? So, here this widow saying, we're going to die, and God came with Elijah. She needed a message. She needed to know that there's a God who's alive. Don't look around at these statues, these totem poles, these Baal idols that they're making and worshiping and giving idols sacrifices to. You know what the Bible says about that? Let's read what Paul said. Here's what Paul says about sacrificing to idols.
Satanic woman that would do these rituals, and their hearts were being
being so far led away from God. And now they're doing this worship. And they knew they were worshiping, they thought God, but it was demons. It was the enemy. And what did the enemy say to a lot of these times when these people would, they would say, bring your kids and sacrifice them to me. They would say all kinds of, do ungodly things that God goes against. So, this is the backdrop that Elijah's fighting in, and standing up for God's holiness. This satanic worship going all over. They said, when they ate the sacrifice, when these pagan cultures would worship Baal and Molech and these satanic idols, they would take that food and they would sacrifice it. Just like God, now back up, when you read the word, I want you to think of a few things. What goes on in the physical realm is there's something going on in the spiritual. That is, there's activity in the spiritual realm that actualizes itself in the physical realm. So you got the physical invisible, where we operate with our senses, and you got the spiritual invisible. So we talk to people with our five senses. That's how we communicate with each other. We have that soul, our mind, our will, emotions. And then we have the spirit. That's the real us, is our spirit. That's how we communicate with God. And you know what? That's how the devil will also communicate with you. You remember it says that David was enticed to count his army. The devil got in his spirit. The devil was whispering in his spirit, so to speak. You got a number. You can't go against somebody if you don't know how many you got. And he's giving him away from that. Man, I defeated lions and bears in the power of God. I defeated giants in the power of God. I don't need to count my army to make sure I got enough men. God's going to give me the victory. But no, he was enticed. So that spiritual battle is going on at all times. They were eating. So they sacrificed this animal to the idols. And then they go and eat it. Now what they thought was, as I eat this sacrificed animal, the spirit that I am worshiping is going to enter me and empower me. So that's what they were doing. And that's why when you flip back to the New Testament, there were people who wouldn't eat idols, they wouldn't eat meat sacrificed to idols. And Paul saying, look, I know your heart's true, you love God, but if that's going to mess you up, if you're going to have a bad head, don't do it. If it don't bother you, go ahead. You serve God. It doesn't matter what prayer somebody prayed over this meat. You serve a living God. But that's what they would do. They would sacrifice these animals, and then when they ate it, they were bringing that spirit into them. So this is all kinds of intertwined spiritual warfare going on here. So the widow made the bread, and God caused that crux of oil that they had for making bread and that flour to not end. It was just continue to flow and flow and flow. And as I said, sometimes we have hard times making ends meet. Sometimes our ends meet in collections. Sometimes our ends meet in the collections of the collections. You ever been there? Oh, we're the second round of collection agencies. We're tougher and better, and we're going to take no compromise. Okay, sometimes your ends will meet in the collections. But God's going to make sure your ends meet spiritually all the time. You know, he might not aid you in every physical ailment. You not might be healed physically. You may not be endowed with great wealth physically. But he's got your back spiritually. The oil, the flour will never run out spiritually if you are connected to God. Okay? So that's what we learned from Elijah, from David, from these great men. When they were connected to God, the power source was right there. It was direct. It was DC current. Divine current, baby, with God. Connected right there. But guess what? God doesn't unplug them. They unplug themselves. And sometimes they said, all right, I'm just going to run on my own power, and I'll be back, God. And sometimes they don't ever come back. Sometimes they connect back in. And we need to make sure that we don't ever unplug, but I know that's silly to say because we unplug sometimes. But make sure we plug back in and learn from what happened. When out in the world without God, always having your back. Because you know what? If you tell God, I got this, I don't need you, he's going to say, I don't know what he's going to say, but he might say, okay, you don't need me? You got this? Let's see this. So then, the widow's son died. They fed Elijah, and then her own son, the one who helped her, the one who did all the stuff because her husband was dead. Her survival in that society had died. And she says, after this is verse 17. After this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill, and his illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. That's pretty severe. And she said to Elijah, what have you against me, O man of God? You have come to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son. Okay? Listen to what she said. You have come to bring my sin into remembrance and have taken my son. You have caused the death of my son. So sometimes when we go out in the world and talk to people about our faith, Rachel and I ran into this yesterday. Sometimes they think there's an agenda. Sometimes they think you're going to bring my sin to remembrance. Okay? And we ran into some opposition a little bit. But it was until they realized that, no, we're here to bless you. We want to share some spiritual truths in life with you. That they became disarmed. But there's a lot of people in that world that think that God is just ready to whack them over their head. That he doesn't care. He just wants to bring a judgment upon you and condemnation. And then people think, I've messed up so much, I'm going to be a spiritual Eeyore, and I'm just going to wallow in my sin, my past, my inability to be anything productive spiritually. But God doesn't want that. Has anybody seen The Way of the Master? Kirk Cameron, Ray Comfort? They go out to, a lot of it's out in California, Huntington Beach and stuff. And they'll go up to people, and they do street ministry. And Ray will be over there, and he'll say, hey, and somebody will come up and stand on a milk crate. And he'll go, hey, have you ever lied? And the guy will go, yeah. He goes, what does that make you? A liar. Have you ever stolen anything? Yeah. What does that make you? A thief. Have you ever looked at a woman to lust? Because Jesus says, if you look at a woman to lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. Yeah, I've done that. And he'll say, by your own admission, you are a lying, thieving, adulterous at heart, and God is going to have to judge you on judgment day. And if you judge you by the Ten Commandments, you're going to go to heaven and hell. And that's how they started. Now, that's good, because I've shown this a lot in youth group. And some of the youth kids go, no, that's not right. I don't like these guys. That's not how you, that's not. And I know adults who say the same thing. And I'm trying to, Rachel and I are trying to get some kind of thing going. And I was asking the youth, is there any youth that was alive? Some of you guys were alive. I was like, what do you say? How do you approach somebody and say, hey, you know, can I just talk to you a little bit about life and about purpose and about, get out of here, old man! What? I'm only 42.
What?
But it's hard. I think you got to get personal, relational at each level. But this lady said, oh man of God, have you come to bring my sin to remembrance? That's a lot of what people think. They think they're that God's all about condemnation. But they forget God sent his son to die in your place. Not to condemn the world, but that through him, you might have life everlasting. That is a good message. And it's good to know, hey, you can't do this on your own. It ain't about good works, because you just said yourself, you're a liar, a thief, an adulteress at heart. That's just maybe half a day in your life or one day. That's why God sent the pure, holy, righteous one to do that. So we go from there, and this is the best. It goes on, and you guys got to read the story of Elijah, because there's a lot more in there. But there's this drought going on. And he's saying, look, man, you guys are worshiping false gods. You guys are not worshiping the one true God. You guys have erected this demonic institution that you guys are paying homage to. And the destruction of your souls will be the end of that. And he goes up and he basically says, let's have a contest. And there's a drought in the land. So the very little water that they have been able to scour, Elijah says, okay, we're going to have two altars here. I'm going to have my altar over here, and you're going to have your altar over there. Now there's 450 of these satanic priests. They're called the priests of Baal. And you have 450 of these satanic priests that are saying, yeah, let's show him whose God is right. So they have their sacrifice, and Elijah has his. They put theirs on their altar with their wood, and Elijah puts his on his altar, but he goes one more. He digs a trench like a moat around the altar, and then he dumps all this water on top of the sacrifice. So now the sacrifice, this dead animal, is soaked in water. Its fur is saturated, and now all the wood is soaked with consume that sacrifice. And from morning till noon, they're out there doing their chants, and they're out there calling on their false god. And they're out there yelling, come on, consume this sacrifice. And Elijah's just saying, your prayers are hitting the ceiling, fellas. You are not worshiping the true God. You cannot call fire down from heaven with these false satanic gods. Give it up. And he starts mocking that. Where's your God? Is he going to the bathroom? Is he busy going to the bathroom? Is he away on a journey and it's busy? Because he's saying, look, man, God can do all things, all powerful. There's nothing. I'm going to just say, God, do this, and he's going to do it. What's wrong with your God? Maybe he's sleeping. Maybe you need to wake your God up. So you know what they say? You know what? He's right. Maybe we need to cut ourselves with knives and swords and rocks. So these fall 450 of these satanic priests, prophets of Satan, are cutting their arms, their legs, their chest, their body. And it says the blood is gushing out. So you got a bloodbath. 450 guys cutting themselves and yelling, and nothing's happening. Because they are worshiping a false religion, a false god, an empty, and that's the broad road. They're worshiping down the broad road. And Elijah calls fire, calls for God to do it. Elijah says, watch, my God's all about this. And like the blowtorch of heaven comes down. I try to picture it. It says like tongues of fire licking up the water in the trench. Could you imagine that? I imagine, was it like the kids have the sparklers on the 4th of July? I don't imagine it was like that. Did you see how Mike lit the fire last night? This guy over at Harmony, he's got this big propane tank, and he's got a huge, like, blowtorch coming out the end of it. And he turns it on, and you can see, like, the fire and stuff 4 feet out. He sets it down by the logs, and the fire's like, but I don't think there was, like, sparkler fire coming down from the sky. When Elijah called God to send fire from heaven, it was probably like a huge blowtorch descending in a flash and consuming. And it lit up the sacrifice, the wood, the water, everything was consumed. You know what Elijah did, Allison? After that, he said, kill them all. Kill them all. 450 of these false prophets were put to death. Killed. So, I want you guys to do this. I want you to live loud for the Lord in your daily walk as you go about town. Don't be flying under the radar. Don't be flying under the spiritual radar with your light that is the new spirit living in you, that glow. Don't put that under a basket. Don't hide your light. Don't hide the fact that you have the answers of a lost soul. And you yourself have been revived and renewed. You're born anew from heaven. Don't hide that fact. Elijah lived loud for the Lord, and he defended the cause of the living God. That's what we need to be about. Defend the cause of the living God. When you see evil, don't call it good. And when you see good, don't call it evil. And don't let anybody try to tell you otherwise. Well, yeah, what about incest and rape and abortion? Do you know less than 1% of abortions are from incest and rape? But yet they use that illogical red herring argument. And they draw you away from the big picture that the slaughter mill of the devil and all these babies, that's Baal worship, that's Moloch worship, sacrificing kids, that's alive and well today. Who do you think you're sacrificing these kids to? It ain't to God, it's to the devil. And what's it say? The devil came to kill, steal, and destroy. Well, when I look and see about abortions and break it down, it looks like there's a lot of killing, stealing, and destroying going on. And even if it is a rape or an incest, you can still put the kid up for adoption. Right? Or am I wrong? Amen. So, he was living loud. Elijah was living loud. He wasn't concealing, flying under the spiritual radar. He wasn't tap dancing around the nation's issues. He was confronting it head on. He was holding the righteousness of God up. Then at the end, if you read the end of where it's talking about Elijah, right before he gives the mantle to Elisha, it talks about God says, I have kept 7,000 people in Israel who haven't bowed their knee to Baal. So when you look around, you go, man, I'm living in a hostile environment. I'm living in a hostile spiritual territory. There's still faithful people, men and women, that God has reserved for him. These people are connected. You look at a spoke on a wheel, you got the hub is God, and there's people. These are the righteous people, the spokes. And sometimes you might feel like all the spokes are broken, God, and you're the only one. But it might be just because you don't have the vantage point to see all the other spokes and where they're at and how they're being used. But it says at the end of this chapter, God tells Elijah, I have reserved 7,000 followers of me who have not bent their knee to Baal. They worship me, and God's wrath is going to prevail, no matter how small it is. It'll prevail one day. But one thing that is significant about Elijah's life was prayer. James says that the prayer of a righteous man will availeth much. Okay, then he goes on in James, the next verse, and he says, Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth bore his fruit. So right before that, James says, the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And then he says about how Elijah was a righteous man in prayer. So, if there's another ABC formula there, I think, what's availeth? Prevail? Would that be the same? We can use that word prevail? The prayer of a righteous man or woman or child will availeth much, will prevail much. So, if the prayer of a righteous man prevails much, it's easy to say that the prayer of an unrighteous man will not prevail. But we're not prevail much. So, we need to seek God in prayer. We need to seek God with a clean heart. And guess what? You can have a clean heart when you're seeking God, just to, you know, God, just cleanse me. It says in 1 John 1:9, confess your sins. He is just and faithful to cleanse you from all your unrighteousness. So here's what I want you to remember. Just because you're on the hub there, you're one side of the spoke, you might feel like you're all alone. But God is faithful to have fellow servants with you. And you might think, I've been praying for this. I've heard stories. I've been praying for my grandson for 27 years. I've been praying for this over and over. God says, keep praying. Keep knocking. Keep seeing. Be persistent. Let me show you something. You see this zipper right here? Alice, I'll be dead. I'm going to open it up. I'm going to pull back a little bit. Okay? And you see in here? This is the spiritual realm. And it's so intertwined with us, but it's invisible. But it's right here. And we can't comprehend it very much, and we can't see it or touch it or taste it or smell it. But I know that when Daniel prayed to God, it took 3 weeks for Gabriel to get to Daniel. And Gabriel shows up and he goes, Daniel, soon as you prayed, that instant, God sent me to you. So 3 weeks ago, God sent Gabriel to come to Daniel. Daniel didn't know his prayer was answered right away. In the spiritual realm, I just opened his zipper up and pulled it back. Here was this mightier fallen angel, the prince of Persia, who was over that Persian area where Daniel was. And Gabriel came to get to Daniel, and the prince of Persia said, no, not so fast. You're not going to him. We got plans for him, other plans that God doesn't have. God wants this, but we're going to do this. And it took 3 weeks, and finally God sent Michael, the archangel. Now Michael shows up on the scene, and he says, Gabriel, go to Daniel, I got this. And Michael took on the prince of Persia, and I don't know how spiritual warfare works. I don't know if they have invisible swords or invisible fire. I don't know how they fight, but there was a battle going on. Gabriel was released, and now Michael roughed up the prince of Persia. And now Gabriel shows up to Daniel and says, soon as you prayed, it was answered. It's God sent me. Go. So sometimes I want you guys to think, Elijah, it says the fervent prayer. Fervent, heartfelt, steadfast, persistent will prevail with God, will avail much. So sometimes you think, I've been praying this for so long. I've been praying this, and it's like my prayers are hitting the ceiling. We don't know what's going on in the spiritual realm. Prayer is, you understand, when you're praying, you are in spiritual combat. Because the devil does not want any kind of righteous, any kind of God's kingdom being advanced. And the one way God's kingdom is advanced is through prayer. Through that reverential, holy, fervent prayer. That's one way we stay connected to God, is through prayer. So prayer is a constant connection with God. Of course, that's one of our biggest weapons. And of course, the devil's going to try to hinder that. So when you get that, the devil tells you, man, God's not answering your prayer, you must have some kind of secret sin in your life. God's not answering your prayer. It must be too minute for him to even want to worry about. Don't believe that. God may have answered it instantaneously. But for some reason, he allows it to play out in the spiritual. But it will manifest itself in the physical. So you don't know if there's spiritual war going on. You know, when I was little, I was in kindergarten, and there was a really busy interstate that went to Alliance called Route 62. And my dad was over there in the car, and there's an old crossing guard. He'd come out with this crosswalk stick, and it said stop on it. And he'd stand out in the middle while the kids walked the other way. Well, there's like a light here, went up the hill, and there's another light over here, and another light by McDonald's and Speedway. And this semi that carries cars, has all the cars on it at different levels, ran this red light. And the crossing guard's out there with the stop sign. He's like, ah! And here's little old Brian. I got my GoBot shoes on. I got my G.I. Joe backpack. And here comes this semi. And meow! And off he goes. And then this crossing guard's spinning around. And I'm like shaking right here. And I'm in my bare feet now. And there's two skid marks where the semi locked up its brakes. Two skid marks. And inside the skid marks are my shoes. But I'm out here outside of them. True story. And my mom always said that there's an angel watching over me. And I'm thinking, yeah. It says that those who fear the Lord and love God, the angel of the Lord encamps around them. So remember, God has got your back. God has got, he's looking over you. He's looking out for you. Whether he can snap something instantaneously and cause it to happen, he might have an angel there by your side. You might think, man, that was really, really, really odd. You know how God works? Let me tell you how God works. We're right alive, and I'm going to the bathroom to brush my teeth, and this lady, probably in her 60s, starts talking to me, and she's like, God brought me through this brain tumor, and God's brought me through this, and she talked about how her son wasn't supposed to live, and he was dying when they were being born. And this one doctor told her, after the surgery and after he came through, the one doctor said, now, he was like the specialist that was able to fix the son. He was like, I wasn't even supposed to be working today. I got called in. I even came in an hour early. I never do that. That's what the doctor said. She's like, that was God. But anyway, she's talking. I said, can you come back to my campsite and talk to the people about what God's brought you through? Because she says, man, I'm staying on this song. I stayed on this song. And she goes, God, I told God he brought me through this. I'm going to share it until the day I die. So she came back to her campsite. Now, while this is going on, one of the girls from our group went over and invited this lady who's like in her 20s or early 30s with two kids. She invited them over. She goes, hey, there's a lady coming, it's talking. Would you like to come over? We'd like you to come over and listen. So this lady comes over, and she's from Toledo, and she's listening, and this lady gives this testimony about all this stuff, and she's talking about her brain tumor, about how she would never be able to do this, and God did this, and she learned it out to, she had to learn all how to talk and to walk and to swallow and to do all this stuff again. And God has brought her through it all. And after it all, this girl's like, this is really weird. She's like, my best friend just got diagnosed with the same thing that she had. And I don't know how to talk to her or minister to her or anything. She's like, this is like just eye-opening. And you see how God works? I mean, that don't happen. God brought that all to, and all the little details in between. There's no saying that's too big a coincidence to be a coincidence. I don't know if that's what I'm saying, but this one I like. Hey, Ann, yes?
So you left out the part that we wasn't even supposed to be in that area.
Oh, yeah, we weren't supposed to be in that campsite. And we were mad because we got our campsites moved. I was like, man, those campsites are right next to the bathroom. And I told Rachel ahead of time, I was like, maybe God's moving us for a reason. And then our campsites were relocated right in between these two people. It was a too big coincidence to be a coincidence. So that's how God works. You don't know how he's going to do it. You don't know when he's going to do it. Here's what you got to do. You got to make yourself available. You're on call 24/7. You are about God's business 24/7. It's not a Sunday thing. It's Monday through Saturday. It's not a day-by-day thing or week-by-week. It's moment-by-moment. You're about God's business. We're just going to end on that. Let's be about God's business. Amen. As the praise team comes up, Lord, we thank you for these encounters. We thank you. Here's what I need, Lord. I need, not only when I pray, I need to listen too, Lord. Elijah was listening. It wasn't in the whirlwind. It wasn't in the this and the that. It was in that calm, small voice, that quietness. And we need to get away with you, Lord. you, Lord, but also to be warriors who listen. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all did that one. I was messing up. Do you need those lyrics? You won't need that.
Stand with us. So confused, and this song is written as a declaration to Satan, but it is also a declaration to the Lord. When I do not know what's going on, I'm going to raise a hallelujah. Come and raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. Come and raise a hallelujah louder than
love Christ.